Welcome back to What Would You Ask podcast. My guest today, if you don't know this guy, then you've been under a rock, or you've been in quarantine too long, or you don't like entertainment or TV or smiling or laughing or whatever, because that's just what he does. That's what he delivers, right? And some controversy, and he likes shaking things up, which is pretty cool. So he's been involved in everything, professional wrestling, reality TV star. He's been on Celebrity Newlywed, and these are just things that I know. Celebrity Poker, Fear Factor. I think I saw him on Pawn Stars, actually. So, I mean, this guy just, he's done it all. He's competed twice, by the way, on Survivor. And that's what we really want to talk to him about today, particularly about season 7 and his experiences on Survivor. He came in third. I mean, this is not, you know, no offense, but it's not a professional athlete, guy that's prepared for this. He just said, yeah, let me give it a shot. He goes and knocks it out third place at Pearl Island. That was filmed in June through July of 2003, and it premiered in September 2003. He also competed in Survivor Micronesia. I believe that was season 16. It is my pleasure to welcome to What Would You Ask podcast the one and only Johnny Fairplay. Johnny, how you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm doing great. Thanks. Appreciate you joining us. So we're going to jump right in. And folks, you guys have sent in so many questions. We're going to work the questions all through the interview. We usually start with quick hitters, which are, you know, the questions right from the fans and of the show. But we're going to just work them all the way through. So Bill from Boston, he asks, castaways get a package, I think, prior to leaving that includes condoms. Is that true? And what else is in the package? Just start right off.
That's not true. We don't get a we don't get a package.
I'm thinking, where did that come from, by the way? Do we have to include
I mean, there's a chest on the island with like medical stuff, and so like we each get a daily vitamin. If you wear contacts, you have a contact case and contact solution. And if you're on meds that are allowed, which is pretty much nothing, then you have those. But and then you have like your like a backup pair of glasses. There are condoms and feminine hygiene products in the chest, but like, I mean, I would make balloon animals with I could make a snake and a worm,
sure,
and a caterpillar. Oh, I'm not really good at balloon animals. Yeah. I don't know if you caught that.
Me either.
But I did those three pretty proficiently. That's just from practice at home.
Understood, and I did catch that, by the way. Ashley from Newport News, Virginia. Your neck of the woods. Well, Newport News, I guess, is not.
Close enough.
Yeah, okay. There are rumors that castaways sneak items on. Have you heard of that? Have you seen it? Any experience around sneaking things on to Survivor?
I saw they do a very thorough check. So the outfit that you wear, you send to them beforehand and they keep it until you go out there. So as far as having things in pockets and stuff like that, that's not a possibility. As far as, you know, bodily, they check you before you go out there bodily wise.
Yeah.
Rumor and innuendo and things of this nature are commonly discussed on my weekly Q&A on my Patreon. Mm-hmm. I have a regular weekly podcast at SurvivorNSFW.com, and I also have a Patreon in which we do a weekly Q&A. We do a monthly Zoom deal. We have ORGs, we have weekly trivia, we also have a game night. It's a lot of fun.
Wow, that's cool.
A member of the secret Survivor NSFW Patreon Facebook group. But the link to that is at adfreensfw.com. So we do talk about the rumor and innuendo stuff more so there than on the free side of things. So, and it's as cheap as $5 a month. So, so give that a try, adfreensfw.com. But yeah, one of those rumor and innuendo type deals is allegedly Richard Hatch had waterproof matches in his butt for All Stars.
Oh my God. I had not heard that one. That is
the human pocket.
There you go. wow. Amazing.
So, Eric, and on Fans versus Favorites Micronesia, Ozzy had put a magnifying glass sewn into the hem of his shorts. Like if you watch the beginning of Fans versus Favorites, Ozzy's wearing these shorts that don't really jive up with his typical clothing attire. Because if you're just like, man, that's an odd choice, you know. Yeah. And it's because the hem was extra thick, and he snuck a magnifying glass in the hem. And so even though it was inspected and everything, that hem was so thick, it didn't stand out. It was a small magnifying glass. And so once the game began, he proceeded to cut open that hem and retrieve the magnifying glass to make a fire.
Eric from Dallas, Texas asks, how much does the production of the show slow down the show? Is that possible?
Some shows more so than others. With Survivor, we have a crew. Like when you're watching a challenge, you're basically seeing what I like to refer to as home plate compared to the entire baseball field. So you see home plate at home. The rest of the field, the outfield, the stands, and all that comprises of about, I think it's 400 people involved in production. Wow. It's insane.
Wow.
So yeah. So no, there's enough cameras and enough manpower out there that they're not doing second takes.
Yeah. Right.
So and now with the advent of drones versus back in the day on Survivor, we had stunt doubles for the overhead shots, because with the plane flying or the helicopter flying overhead, you would hear it and you know it would be a sound nuisance production wise. Yeah. And so they would have the screenshots of where we were, what we were doing, and then they would have our stunt doubles in those spots just for the overhead shot, in the middle of a challenge. It was just like a quick 2 second throwaway shot, but that you could see. So, but with the advent of drones, now drones are also included in that production of over 400 people. So wow. They're not missing anything, and nothing is slowed down.
That's amazing. That's really cool. Yeah. Aaron from, where is she from? Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania says, hi, Johnny, you are my favorite in season 7. I love you. Okay. Sorry for the 3-part question. What is the funniest thing that's happened while you were on Survivor? The funniest thing that's happened. Okay.
I mean, I thought the dead grandma lie was pretty funny. I enjoyed everyone else's misery from that, and my pure satisfaction and enjoyment of pulling it off. Every day, a lot of people. I mean, I play the role of the villain / bad guy / heel. I mean, that's a role that I embrace and I brought to Survivor. Mm-hmm. Prior to me, anyone that had been portrayed as a quote unquote bad guy, kind of felt that they got a bad edit. They're like, that's not me. I'm not, blah, blah, blah. And it's like, well, it's reality TV. They don't CGI. So you did say that stuff, yeah. And you can position it however you want and control the narrative in certain ways. However, if you were portrayed a bad guy, you were probably a bad guy. You just right. don't know it.
That's right.
So with me, I embraced that role and I went in. I'm just like, I want to be the biggest bad guy in the history of reality television. And I felt I did. And with that theme of my character, I understand the viewer at home or, can watch and say, well, that guy's an a-hole and no one likes him. But in reality, I'm telling that story mostly through confessional. So, I didn't sit out there on the island and go, hey, yeah. I'm a scumbag, hate my guts.
That's a good point. That's
not the conversation I'm having out there. I'm telling you, the viewer, that I'm a scumbag. So, you go back and watch Pearl Islands, Rupert kind of sucked. He had no social skills. He disappeared all day to find the baby shark and the mama shark. Yeah. And unsuccessfully daily. Right. And as I said, little to no social skills, where, I'm interacting all day. I'm for better or worse, the television for the people on the island. I was Roddy Piper's personal assistant prior to Survivor. I'd been living in Los Angeles, for a couple of years prior to Survivor. So I had some pretty amazing stories. Right. So every day it was just story time with Johnny Fairplay. Everyone's bored out of their mind. If there's not a challenge or tribal, you're bored. There's nothing to do. And so I was entertainment. So, you know, so yes, I do tell you the, like, you know, Rupert tells you, the viewer, everyone loves me, I'm the provider, I'm the hero. And I tell you, everyone hates me, I'm the villain, I'm the bad guy. But in reality, it was kind of reverse.
Makes sense. Yeah. Erin finishes her question with, is there any other reality TV show that you would like to be on? F Danny Bonaducci. That's how she finishes her email.
Me and Danny are cool now. It's fine. Okay. So I sued him and Fox, and I did pretty good.
There you go.
It looks like they might be doing a Survivor episode of Flora's Lava. And don't be surprised if you see yours truly there. And as far as other shows, I mean, like, people ask all the time, they're like, would you do Big Brother? And the celebrity version, yes. I think that's like 2.5 weeks that I would leave my family for. But regular Big Brother's 3 months, and I have a 12-year-old daughter and a 3-year-old daughter, and I have no desire to be gone for three months plus, you know, now the 14-day quarantine before that. So you're now looking at 4 months. I have no desire to be away from my family for that long. So, you know, the granddaddy of them all, as far as show-wise is concerned, is Survivor. That's my love, you know, my one true love in reality TV. I've had lots of fun doing other shows. And if there was an original, unique, new concept out there, I would definitely entertain the idea. But timing-wise, I would need a month or less total. That would be my max. And, you know, as far as what I have left in the tank or what I want to do, you know, either an old school versus new school season of Survivor or a legend season. But that's about it. I won Celebrity Bull Riding. You know, I was on Celebrity Fear Factor, the only person to be brought back ever in the show, the only person to co-host with Joe Rogan. You know, I won Celebrity Newlywed Game. I was on Celebrity Poker Showdown with a pretty outrageous moment. You know, I did Kill Reality, Camp Reality. I've done 70 plus television shows. So there, you know, as far as, you know, that one dangling carrot out there that I missed, I didn't. I got it.
There's only one I want to ask you about, and this is not a viewer question, but sure. I see you on Amazing Race. I know you, we're doing a series with Amazing Race right now, and we're interviewing and watching a ton of stuff. We've done a video.
Sure.
That's got you written all over it with all the mental and physical. It's kind of like Survivor on, I don't know, around the world kind of thing.
Yeah. Yes and no. So after my first season of Survivor, they asked me to do the Amazing Race with my grandmother. And, you know, my grandmother's like 70 years old at the time. And I'm just like, we wouldn't make it to the first airport.
Right.
And I'm just like, that's, you know, I was just like, you know, me and Burton from Pearl Islands, I'm all in there just like, you and Burton easily win. And I'm like, great. That's a good TV
Let's
show.
Go. Let's, yeah.
I want to watch that.
Yep.
So no, I turned them down to do it with my grandmother and, you know, and if that were revisited, you know, 15 years later or whatever, you know, with my grandmother, the answer is extra no. I do know for the reality version that they did, when they contacted Rupert to play with his wife, he actually countered with me as his partner.
Wow.
And they're like, we're asking you to do this with your wife. And he's like, yeah, I understand that. I would rather do it with Johnny Fairplay. So for a multitude of, I mean, it's not like Rupert and I are friends. There's still no love loss.
Yeah.
But he knows he has a better chance with me. I'm, you know, strategy and everything else that I bring to the table. There's very few people that have that resume. So that I understand. Number two, it's great television. Rupert and I together is, I mean, that's pretty funny. I get it. And number three, that would be enough potentially to create to renew that rivalry that we had on Pearl Islands to merit a, you know, a captain themed season of Survivor.
Yeah.
So I think Rupert looked at all the stuff, you know, after Amazing Race, playing with me as his partner and all the benefits that it would entail having me as his partner.
Got it.
But his wife heard him on the other line going, what are you saying?
Dumping me for Johnny. That's actually pretty cool because I guess most of us presume that you and Rupert weren't best of friends, and for him to realize that you would be better TV, better partner, probably better success rate if you went together, that's pretty cool to hear.
And it took about, I mean, like, you know, Rupert and I did charity event. I mean, you know, like post Survivor, you know, we're at the People's Choice Awards together and other things. And then we're doing charity events along the way. And so, you know, my interaction with Rupert didn't end with Pearl Islands. You know, it was multiple times a year post Survivor. And it took about 3 years for Rupert to finally realize that without me, there's no him. And without and I knew immediately without him, there's no me. I'm the yin to his yang.
No doubt.
You know, if you don't hate me, you don't love him
right
as much.
All right.
And if you don't love him, you don't hate me as much. And those exponential factors on each side are what make me one of the greatest bad guys in the history of reality television, and what make Rupert one of the most beloved heroes in the history of or Survivor and reality television.
I agree. Quick programming note, if you want to get your questions asked by your favorite Survivor star or Amazing Race or Big Break or all the other series that we're doing, head to our website, whatwouldyouask.com. And then everywhere my kids go to on social media, Twitter, Instagram, all that. It's all under What Would You Ask? We are speaking with Johnny Fairplay. If you don't,
I'm doing a lot of talking, so you're listening.
No, yeah, that's true. That's a good point. So talk about the journey. Everybody's asking about you. How did that even evolve, you coming on to Survivor? And then, you know, what was it like to just jump in with both feet?
I was living in Los Angeles, and my buddy, a girl my buddy was talking to, picked me up to take me to a Von Dutch party. And so we stop in Santa Monica to get gas, and this white Volvo locks up the brakes. She goes, "You mind if I ask you a crazy question?" I'm like, "You're hot, why not?" She goes, "You ever watch Survivor?" I go, "No, they're a bunch of losers." Because I'm the casting director. I go, "That sucks for you." She goes, "I'm offering you a 1 in 16 chance at $1 million." I'm like, "Whatever." She goes, "I think you'd be perfect." I go, "Tell me something I don't know, honey." She goes, "That's it, you're on." So the person that locked up the brakes was the head of casting, Lynn Spillman. And so the next day, you know, I'm filling out forms and moving into a hotel for 11 days, I believe, for finals of casting. And I'd never seen the show. I take that back. I watched like 5 minutes of the first season finale, and I was like, "These people are stupid. I would never do this." So, but otherwise I never really watched the show. Like, I was more of a fan of Real World and stuff like that. So,
yeah.
And, so once I was cast, you know, I went and I watched every season twice, really studied the game. I became skin diver and scuba diver certified in Catalina. I was running, I don't know, like 5 to 10 miles a day, in Runyon Canyon in preparation. So I feel as far as, you know, for being someone, you know, there's two forms of players on Survivor. There's recruits, and there's people that actually, you know, apply. And I feel that I'm easily the most prepared recruit in the history of the show. And I would argue that I'm one of the most prepared, you know, even people that would have applied. So, I mean, I really think, you know, studying and analyzing and breaking down the game, not necessarily, well, we, you know, in most part, in some part strategically, but I looked at the television component of it, you know? So like I broke down, you know, what production is trying to achieve in this aspect of the show. And so I think going into that, maybe there's someone since me that's done something, you know, possibly better, but you know, I think in the history of the show, I feel I brought the most preparation of anyone. I mean, just can't imagine, you know, just knowing, you know, all the survivors that I do and what they went in with. I feel pretty strong in my statement.
Well, that took care of Christina's question from Huntington Beach, California. She asked about your preparation once you found out you were going on. What was that like? And to say that you just watched every episode twice and started working out and committing to the thing, I mean, that shows you that you were going in this thing, not just to raise havoc and be the villain that you talk about, but also you understood the physical stress of this thing.
Sure.
And what did it do to your diet, just off the cuff? Is that a problem too?
Not, I mean, for me, like I'm currently at 145 pounds, which has been my, it's pretty much my, I still run today, 3 to 10 miles daily. I ran a 10K on Saturday. I finished first place men's masters, division. And I have a half marathon coming up at the end of August in Asheville, North Carolina. So I try to do at least a couple half marathons a year. And as I said, I run pretty much every day. I play tennis on Saturdays. I do clay courts, kind of protect the knees a little bit. But as far, like, as I said, I'm 145 now. 2003, I started the game at 116 pounds. And I had attempted to gain weight for Pearl Islands, but so I was eating McDonald's a couple times a day, Pink's hot dogs a few times a week. I was drinking those metric shakes and drinking Guinness beer every night. I was doing everything, but you know, but the fact that, you know, I was 30 years old running 5 to 10 miles a day and with just, you know, just naturally a high metabolism, 116 was the most I could go out there with. Like, and I do have the record for most rewards enjoyed by a single survivor on a single season ever in the history of the show. And so I received every food reward other than one for the 38 days that I was out there. So my starting weight was 116. My finishing weight was 113.
Wow. That's keeping it together because a lot of people drop a lot more than that. So
yeah, like Big Tom dropped, I think 65 pounds or 75 pounds.
Yeah.
I think Rupert dropped 40. So, I mean, like most people drop between 20 and 40. Like that's the norm.
That's amazing. Mackenzie from Summit, New Jersey asks, when you got on the island, did the castaways know who you were? Was that, and that, did that end up being a good thing or make you a target?
What do you mean? Like what's,
did they recognize who's here? Like, did they recognize you were on the island and did that adversely affect you, or were they fans? Were they not fans? Did they,
are you talking about like for fans versus favorites when I went back?
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, everyone there watches the show, so yeah, they all knew who I was.
Yeah. Come on, McKenna.
So, yeah, I mean, like I had pregame, I had flown out to Los Angeles. I had lunch with Penner. We had a conference call with Yao Man. So I had an alliance there. Eliza and I were friends from charity events, so we were cool going out there. No one had met James and Amanda yet because their season was still Survivor China was still airing at that time, and we became fast friends. Amy Kuzak actually hated me from our interactions. Starting with her finale and you know, seeing her after that. But then, you know, fast forward a day and a half in and Amy Kuzak's like, do I love you more than any survivor ever in the history of Survivor? And I'm like, probably. So, I mean, I think plenty of people had preconceived notions of me, but like, I'll ruin whatever you think about me once you meet me. I mean, you know, for those that have become, you know, patrons, you know, of the Survivor SFW podcast, you know, they're just like, holy moly, does this guy work overtime to try to over deliver each and every month, you know, just a one of a kind, original, unique fan interaction that, you know, that's, you know, on a one-to-one level on so many counts. You know, I don't publicize this because I don't need to, and I don't care to. And I think that others that have to, I think, you know, they're potentially doing it for the wrong reasons. But in the history of reality television, I've raised more money for Elizabeth Glaser Pediatric AIDS Foundation than any other survivor. As far as other charities, I've raised tens of thousands of dollars for grassroots soccer, promoting AIDS awareness in South Africa. I just finished a fundraiser of over $3,000 building Christian schools in South Africa. And then every week or every year for the past few years, I raise money for Give Kids the World Village, and they provide transportation and housing for Make-A-Wish kids down in Orlando in Celebration, mm-hmm. Florida. And that's done through Hearts Reality. And so, but you know, I don't do those to justify being a bad guy or to say, hey, you know, I can be a good guy too. I do those because I have a platform and an ability to do that. And I just feel it's my role as you know, as secretly a good person to do those things.
Yeah. It doesn't sound like a villain to me. It sounds like who you are.
Don't tell anybody.
Yeah. We won't keep that secret. So Johnny, as you probably imagine, there's two things, or there are many things that people asked about, sure. But we had tons of questions around the grandma dying, you know, scheme. I don't know what you would call it, but sure. Everybody wants to hear about how that was, the origin of that, how it played out. And some people, even people that are rabid fans, want to hear how that thing really worked out. I mean, Jeff Probst called it the greatest lie in Survivor history.
It's actually in the Smithsonian. So like to encapsulate, like that's the scene they have in the capsule in the Smithsonian as an illustration of the greatest moment in the history of reality television.
So tell us about it.
Well, here is my mentor, Andy Kaufman.
There you go.
And I just, you know, a lot of the times out there, I just thought, you know, what would Andy do? And going into the game, what would Andy do? And I think Andy Kaufman is one of the most compelling characters in the history of television and comedy. And, you know, as I said, definitely an influence on me personally. And so, once again, I had never seen Survivor, and you know, so watching each season going into Pearl Islands, I would get to the Loved Ones Challenge and I would cry. And I'm just like, holy moly, you know, this is very emotional. This is great television. You know, I enjoyed it. And so I was like, well, you know, if I'm this horrible person, you know, and it's making me cry, there has to be a way that I can exploit this for the idiots that would be unsuspecting. And so season six, Amazon, the season, you know, one season prior to Survivor Pearl Islands, during the food auction reward, everyone kind of lost on purpose at the end so that Jenna Maraska could get a letter from her mom who was dying at the time and kind of see how her mom was doing. And so watching that, I was like, well, what's more sympathetic than a dying mom, a dead grandmother? And so I kind of based it on that. And my biggest hurdle was finding a big enough scumbag to go through with it once they came around the corner to participate in the Loved Ones Challenge. And so I found that person. It was Thunder D. He is equal scumbagginess to myself. And you know, peek behind the curtain, as we like to say, on the Patreon side of things of our podcast. And that's once again at adfreensfw.com. Give us a try for 1 month. Come on, you'll love it. When Thunder D hugs me, he whispers, Roddy Piper got fired from SmackDown. And my reply is, I don't care. Tell me my grandma died. And then that's when you see the dude, she died dude. Oh. But Thunder D's first thought is to update me on Roddy Piper's career status in WWE at that time.
Oh, that is great. That is funny. Yes. And I actually remember when he got fired.
There you go.
Yeah, that's funny. Oh, man. And then is it true that the castaways, as they say, they didn't find out till post-Survivor, right? Is that true?
They found out when it aired.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Yeah, they saw the episode, and then they're like, holy crap, are you kidding me? So yeah, they had none of them had any clue. Like, and you know, I may be wrong, but I'm willing to bet dollars to donuts on this. Everyone thinks that Sandra figured out that I was lying during that challenge because you see her lack of care, you know, to the lie and to the, you know, to the happenings at that time. And I'm gonna say that I'm unequivocally positive that she didn't know. She just didn't care that I think in Sandra's head, she's just like, okay, this guy's grandma died. Him winning this reward doesn't bring her back. Right. You know, he knew she was dying. She died. Like, what real information is out there? Versus Sandra's like, my husband's here.
Yeah.
I want to see my husband.
Yeah.
So I think that disregard that you see isn't Sandra solving the case and Nancy Drewing it going, no, something's rotten in Denmark. It's, I don't care.
That's awesome. The second area of discussion that our viewers and listeners wanted to probe into was Jeff Probst's relationship with you. I want to read you a quote and get your feedback on this. It says, it was actually fun to work with Fairplay on the show because he's a producer's dream. When he shows up drunk or flips someone off, he brings you gold every time. I wish I had Johnny Fairplay every season. That's one side of it. The other side of it is, personally, he says, he's an absolute jackass whose actions at the Vanuatu, thank you, finale after party pissed me off so much that he's banned from any event that I go to now.
Sure.
Give me your thoughts on that quote.
He's right and he's right. Jeff Probst is 2 for 2. So, no, I mean, like, I know what I bring to the table television-wise. And I think I'm a very unique character. I think I'm very good at what I do. And it is a character. I mean, you know, I legally changed my name to Johnny Fairplay in 2012. And I think I know that character. I think I can bring that character, you know, when the individual situations present itself. And I also know that that character, being me turned up to 11, is sometimes abrasive, sometimes an a-hole. And in the past, you know, there was a drunken part of that. So that part is subtracted. So you can subtract, you can discount that from the equation. And as far as the Vanuatu finale, I was a complete ass. So I think his feelings were justified and merited. And I'm with Probst on that assessment of that evening, myself and our interactions. So, you know, that was 2005, whatever. Whenever it was, that was 15 years ago. And we've been in communication since then. We're, it's very amicable on each side. And I look forward to seeing Jeff in the not so distant future.
Well, that brings us up to what's going on with you today. The other question, probably one of the top three, was, are we going to see you back on Survivor? Everybody that was one of their questions asked, sure. And I think you've touched on that a little bit, but I think they're crazy. Jeff said, you know, he's much more than the host of this show too, by the way.
Yeah. He's the showrunner, executive producer, casting. He has his fingerprints on the show as a whole, as we know it today. So I think in 2020, we're in a pretty good spot as far as those of you rooting for me to make return. I had on multiple times said, you know, I would only want to go back for the right theme. You know, if it's Heroes, Villains 2, if it's Legends, if it's old school versus new school, any of those themes I would be cool with. 2020 Johnny Fairplay, I don't care what the theme is, put me back out there. So I'm ready. So I'll do Blood versus Water, I'll do whatever. I'm confident enough in my game that I think I could show what people want to see. I think I can make it to the end of the game, and I think I can win the game.
Well, like, look, the facts talk, like the host of the show is saying that this guy is gold, right? And by the way, the numbers, forget just what Jeff's saying, the numbers dictate that Pearl Islands was one of the top rated all time shows. And all the critics and the podcasters and bloggers and everybody else, they always put it in the top five. And so if you're looking at the data,
top three is the correct answer.
Yeah, for top three. Okay. That's fair enough. If you're looking at the data and that's what it says, and you're the showrunner and this guy's gold, I mean, we don't have to, you know, point you in the right direction. He should know the direction. So we're looking forward to that. Tell everybody what's going on with you now. You mentioned the podcast and other stuff. Talk about that a little bit.
Sure. I'm a realtor in the state of Virginia, And so if you're looking to buy or sell a house or invest in rental property or looking for rental property management, I'm your guy. Hit me up on social media. I'm at Johnny Fairplay on Twitter, at Johnny Fairplay on Instagram, and facebook.com/Johnny Fairplay. There's no H in Johnny. It's JonnyFairplay. As I said, I run every day. I play tennis once a week. I have a big garden in my backyard. I do cameos. I feel like I do about 10 cameos a day. I price mine right. Mine are only $15, and I actually go outside every single time so that you feel like I'm in the jungle when I do it, and I have a lot of fun, and I riff and improv when I do those. Those are available at cameo.com/Johnny Fairplay. And my biggest love right now, I have Matt Bischoff from Survivor, Caramo and Fans versus Favorites 2, with the guy with the 5-foot beard. He joins me each week along with Zach Hacker. He's a novelist that's really brought an extra punch to our podcast with all the information and facts that he brings to the interviews each and every week. And then all of that can be found at SurvivorNSFW.com. And of course, the best way to support the podcast is to become a patron. And as I said, you get ad-free versions of the free podcast. You get it a week early, and you get added to the secret Facebook Patreon group. We have weekly trivia, weekly top 10 lists, ORGs, all these fun things. It's a really fun group. We have 111 patrons currently.
Wow.
And once we hit 200 patrons, I'm getting Matt's face tattooed on my body. So let's get that number sooner rather than later. And to become a patron, as I said, just try it for 1 month. Go to adfreensfw.com.
That's awesome. And by the way, folks, $15 cameo. I've sent a few out to, actually sent one to my old man in New York City. Just wanted to give him one of his favorite athletes. So we sent that out. $15 is, I'd be on it all day sending them out from Johnny, because you know it's going to be entertaining. So take
it. It's fun. I get a lot of tips. Like it's crazy. Like I get like $75 tips. It's just like, holy.
So, well, you should be at the $100. You're giving a gift to everybody. That's awesome.
I just want it available to as many people as possible, you know, and it, once again, you know, yes, I play a bad guy. Yes, I embrace the role of a bad guy. Please only think of me as a bad guy. But like, you know, my favorite characters growing up were, you know, Lex Luthor and the Joker and Ric Flair and Roddy Piper.
Yeah.
You know, Hulk Hogan sucked. Yeah. Hulk Hogan when he turned bad was great.
Yeah.
So this is coming from a guy with the Ultimate Warrior jacket. it's fun having the opportunity to give back to share and to, you know, put some smiles on some faces, you know, especially during a really unusual and crazy time that we're living in 2020. Yeah.
Well, Johnny, listen, I know that this articulate guy that does really well and cares about people is definitely the act. You are a bad guy and a villain. We all know that. It's obvious through this podcast. Folks, keep the secret, will you? Because
yeah. Oh, one last, I forgot. I have t-shirts at johnnyfairplay.com, and with every t-shirt purchase, you get a phone call from me thanking you for your purchase.
Oh, how about that? And it's J-O-N-N-Y, right? J-O-N-N-Y.
Yeah, JonnyFairplay. Links to everything, Patreon, t-shirts, everything are at SurvivorNSFW.com. But yeah, this is my Dirty Harry shirt. Dirty Harry is one of my favorite players from Australian Survivor. I think we have like over 100 shirts now. We were covering, Matt, Zach, and I were covering that show Labor of Love on Fox, because Dr. Marcus Lehman from Survivor Gabon was a contestant, and Matt Stryker from WWE and Lucha Underground was also a contestant on there. And Matt Bischoff, each week, you know, he would talk about the, you know, the hooking up and you know, whether it be with Christy, the object of their desire on the show, or by themselves, you know, in a house full of guys, you know, maybe finding that alone time. And so just dropped yesterday is our coital stimulations shirt. Which it doesn't matter what the shirt is. You get a phone call from me, Johnny Fairplay, thanking you for your purchase. And we also have, I believe, 8 shirts available featuring Sundi Burquist. She was a contestant on Survivor Millennials versus Gen X. And Sunday was recently diagnosed with two forms of cancer, and she's in for the fight of her life that she will win. And we have some Sunday Schooled Cancer shirts available at johnnyfairplay.com, and all profits from that shirt go directly to Sunday. So we PayPal her every month with all the profits from that shirt. So if you want to do something good today, there's something really fun and good to do.
That's awesome. Johnny, thanks for the time today. We really appreciate it. We are all rooting for you to get back out on Survivor so we can see you do your thing. And
thank you. I hope I didn't ruin all the mystique. Like, you know, people out there just like, ugh, what happened?
So, I think they know what they get.
I'm just as evil with that camera in front of me. Nothing's changed, guys. Don't worry.
Thanks, Johnny. We'll talk again soon.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.